This is astronaut Neil Armstrong, command pilot for the Apollo 11 moon landing mission. What is the purpose of the Apollo 11 mission?
Apollo 11 is man's first attempt to demonstrate the ability to go to the moon, to land there, and to return to Earth.
What are your responsibilities as commander of Apollo 11?
Well, in general, the responsibilities of the commander are to make the onboard decisions whenever they're required and to oversee the performance of the duties of all the crew, including himself. Now, in this particular case, I participate in those procedures on board the spacecraft as well as oversee those of my fellow crew members, and the specific tasks that I'm charged with the performance of include the monitoring of the launch, board procedures should they be required, manual flying of the booster should that be required, and taking my turn on watch in the normal monitoring of spacecraft systems in the command module. In the lunar module, I'm charged almost nearly equally with the lunar module pilot in the operation of the lunar module systems and control of the vehicle during descent and ascent.
Would you describe what will be happening just before the lunar module touches down on the moon?
We will continue burning the engine until an altitude of only about 5 feet at which the probes will ignite the a light on our panel. We see it illuminate, we cut the engine, and fall the last several feet to touchdown.
Columbus explored one new world. You're about to explore another. How do you feel about such comparisons?
Well, I'm very impressed to be compared with Columbus, and of course we recognize his discovery and have honored it in some respects by the call sign of our command module, Columbia. There are some favorable comparisons and some that won't hold true. Certainly, Columbus's venture was one that was very expensive in his time. It was one that very few countries could afford, and Spain could afford only by digging into the very depths of their treasury. It was a voyage with a good bit of risk and some complaints. However, in many ways, it was not at all like the voyage of Apollo 11. First, he wasn't sure where he was going. At least he thought he was going to China or the Indies, and ended up, of course, in a completely new world. Now, I very much hope that we won't terminate at some place that we didn't expect to, some planet that we hadn't planned to visit. I think we know a good bit about the place that we are going, and it's also necessary to notice that he did it without an entire nation's efforts behind him. Our voyage is the voyage of a nation and a voyage of humanity, while his was a voyage of a very limited few.
This is astronaut Michael Collins, command module pilot for the Apollo 11 mission. What do you think will result from the Apollo 11 flight?
Obviously, we've opened up a travel system which is heretofore been impossible. We now will be able to offer to human beings the option of either walking on the surface of the Earth or walking on the surface of the moon, or hopefully in some not too far distant date, the option of walking on the surface of some other planet. And I think that the possibilities therein are almost limitless. However, as I say, before such an event, I'm poorly equipped to say in great detail what they may be. Historically, we've been unable to predict the benefits of various inventions or various discoveries.
How do you view your role as command module pilot?
Well, Apollo was designed to be a three-man job, and the third, which I perform, is, I think, as important, no more so, no less so, than the other two positions. I think I'd be a fool if I said that I had the best seat of the three. On the other hand, I can say with complete candor and with complete honesty that I'm very happy to have the seat which I have and to be doing the job that I intend to do.
Will you be kept pretty busy as you fly alone in the command module?
Yes and no. I hope I'll be very unbusy. I have two roles to play. First, I act as the passive target vehicle, and in the event that everything is working perfectly within the LEM, then I am not unduly busy. I have many chores to do, and I prepare to take an active role in bringing the two vehicles together. However, as I say, provided the LEM works and can, its radar is working properly and it's capable of making each and every maneuver leading up to the rendezvous and docking, then my job is essentially a quiescent one. On the other hand, should difficulties arise within the LEM, then my job is to rescue the LEM, and I then find myself becoming the active partner in charge of a very complex vehicle with a very complex job, and this is when I truly become busy, and I'm literally racing from one side of the cockpit to the other, getting solutions to various problems from my digital computer, making sure that my rendezvous radar transponder and VHF ranging systems are working properly, and doing a host of other small details, all of which are necessary for the successful completion of the rendezvous.
This is astronaut Edwin Aldrin, lunar module pilot for the Apollo 11 moon landing mission. What's the first thing you and Neil Armstrong will do after landing?
One of the first things that we will be engaged in is making immediate decisions as to how long we'll be staying on the surface. There are several favored abort points that we will be checking various systems to get a stay or no stay beyond these points. The first one occurs some 4 or 5 minutes after touchdown, the next one about 10 minutes, and the final stay occurs one revolution afterward. What we will be doing during that first revolution is very intensely preparing the vehicle for a simulated countdown to launch, which we will carry up to the last 5 or 10 minutes before the ascent, one revolution later as the command module comes over. Following this period, we'll go through a power down of the systems in the lunar module, preparing it for an extended stay on the surface. We will have an eat period followed by about a 4-hour rest period. When we awake, hopefully from much needed sleep of 4 hours, we'll have another eat period and go through about a 2-hour plus EVA preparation period.
About exploring the moon's surface, astronaut Aldrin had this to say.
Following the EVA preparation period, we will go through the planned two-man excursion on the surface, with Neil exiting the spacecraft first. As he goes down the ladder, I'll be taking pictures of him with a 16-millimeter camera through the window. Television camera will also be recording his activities. Initially, he'll collect a contingency sample as I descend onto the surface. He will then be collecting a bulk sample of a larger sample of the lunar material. While he's doing this, I'll be participating in an extended EVA evaluation, just what are the capabilities of man to perform tasks on the lunar surface. We'll then join together following the deployment of television and perhaps the deployment of the flag on the surface. We'll then perform jointly an inspection, walking around the lunar module, looking at the various systems, the landing gear, making a very thorough inspection of everything that we can observe on it. In the process of doing this, we'll be taking a series of panorama photographs at three different locations as we move around. When we get to the about three quarters of the way around the LEM, we'll begin to deploy several experiments. One is a laser retro reflector, and we'll offload these two from the scientific equipment bay. The other experiment is a passive seismometer. The deployment of these experiments will take some 5 to 10 minutes, and they're to be deployed some 50 to 60 feet away from the lunar module. We return from this excursion around the lunar module. We'll then pick up the equipment for a documented sample in detail in a predetermined location some 40, 50, 60 feet away from the lunar module. Following this, we'll package up these samples, conduct a few core tube samples and other brief experiments, pick up the solar wind experiment, and then prepare these packages to be transported up into the lunar module. I'll enter into the LEM first, and then Neil will convey these two sample return containers up on this tether assembly. Once they're inside, then he'll re-enter the lunar module, and we'll pressurize, and that'll be the end of our EVA.